I've been playing with the Intel Arc B580 for a couple of weeks now, both gaming and productivity. Today, we talk about what I found and if it's worth the $360 I spent on it. Let's begin. Last week, I presented you my new addition to the studio. I've built a PC which can play games and edit 4K in a decent budget. If you want more details, I recommend you watching that video. However, today's subject is the GPU, a Sparkle Titan OC Intel Arc B580, which is paired with an AMD Ryzen 7 5800X and 32GB of RAM DDR4. The GPU comes with 12GB of GDDR6 VRAM, 192-bit bus size, and it is built on the XE2 architecture, 5nm at TSMC. My version is slightly overclocked compared with the Founders Edition variant, going up to 2740 MHz in boost and has a TDP of 200 watts. It's quite long, 315 millimeters, so be careful with the case if you want to fit this in there. On the back, we got one HDMI 2.1a port and three DisplayPort 2.1 ports. Then we go to the side and find a 1/8-pin connector for the power. There is more specs, but I will talk about them once we get to the testing part. Speaking of which, how well does it do? I'll begin with video editing, as this is the main purpose of this build. I'm filming most of my videos with a Sony ZV-E10 in AVCHD format, which is transmitted via MPEG. The format is basically the way a video is being compressed. Some of them are more efficient, like smaller file sizes and easier to compress, but do not keep a lot of information. Some of them are, on the contrary, quite heavy, hard to manipulate and decompress, huge file sizes, but retain a lot of information. AVCHD has a bit of both worlds, slightly leaning to the latter. Very good quality out of the camera, but quite harsh with the resources of the machine. For comparison, my Mac Mini M2 with 8GB of RAM could handle playback with normal cuts in DaVinci Resolve, but God forbid you put any transitions or graphics or effects there. Rendering and export times were fine, but I needed a better experience in the timeline. Now, I know that it's not only the GPU which is important in this equation, but GPU support is mandatory. I was a bit skeptical because I know that B580 is still not optimized to its best for DaVinci Resolve per Puget Bench, but I put my faith into it, as I tried my best to stay away from 8GB of VRAM. I'm using DaVinci Resolve, the free version, and edit 4K 30fps AVCHD from my Sony camera. Let me show you how playback works. In a 4K 30fps timeline, simple playback with some cuts and fades applied works fine. No hiccups really. I can hear the fans going a bit faster, but the temperatures are fine and the experience is good overall. My main issue before was that I couldn't play anything that had a transition or graphic effect applied, like I simply couldn't. Now I can play, let's say, 90% of the timeline without any issue. Obviously, I have to wait for DaVinci to render everything, but that's fine. I can actually see what's going on there. And yes, it is not perfect. It has a limit, obviously. But for this type of videos, like the one that you're watching right now, it is more than fine. And overall, I'm happy with it. Bottom line is that the B580 would be a good start in video editing, as long as you pair it with something like 32GB of RAM at least. As for render, encode and export times, 12 minutes clip in HVEC format MP4 plus H265 takes around 5-6 minutes in total to be rendered and then exported. MP4 AV1 takes about the same, maybe just a bit longer, and there is one problem that I found. The B580 has an issue with AV1. For some reason, the file I export doesn't play well. And when I try to play it on a Mac, for example, it says it's incompatible. And I'm quite sure it is a bug. I did not really do a lot of research on it, but I do not have a lot of time to spare for that, so I'll just keep using H.265 until I find the solution. And yes, I can confirm that H.265 looks amazing. By the way, as a side note, Windows, or rather Microsoft, is charging me €1 if I want to play an HEVC video. Come on now. What the f*** is Windows 10 Pro as well? I mean, it's €1, not a lot, but really? Nothing else to report here. I would say some support is still needed, and fortunately, Intel is coming with driver updates quite often. Now, let's get to gaming and see how this boy right here is doing. I do not have a lot of games to test, but I believe that what I'll show you here is quite enough. Worth noting that I had to turn on resizable bar, which in this case, with this GPU, is quite important. Resizable bar, or rebar for short, is a PCIe function which basically allows the CPU access the entire frame buffer or the memory of the GPU. Without it, the GPU can receive data in blocks of 256 megabytes out of 12 gigabytes. Rebar basically puts the entire memory at CPU's discretion. Like that, the communication between the two is much better, and in some cases, it will also improve the performance. We'll take this into consideration a bit later, and you will understand why. As a disclaimer, some games are different, and some of them might be CPU bound rather than GPU. Most of them are simulators, but also take into consideration that when you have a lot of objects in front or around you, the CPU might need to step in a bit more than the GPU. To understand how this relationship works, the CPU is the one which basically does the calculations and the movements and everything. The GPU only shows what the CPU is calculating. My selection is in general GPU bound, so we're good to go from here. I played all games in 1080p because I believe this is the ideal resolution for this price bracket. But keep in mind that this card can do some 1440p as well. We'll begin with esports, where Dota 2 and CS2 run comfortable at around 180-200 FPS on average, with the 1% low around 120-140 FPS. Everything cranked up to ultra, with the CPU temps reaching a maximum of, let's say, 70 degrees Celsius, nothing more than that. EAFC 25 will also run quite smoothly at ultra settings, even with some ray tracing on, but keep in mind that we are talking about normal offline kickoff. Alan Wake 2 works decent at medium settings, both the average and the 1% low setting at around 50-60 FPS, maybe sometimes going to that 45-ish mark. High and ultra will get you just around that 30 FPS mark, which is still playable and good, but you might have drops here and there under the 30 FPS. Personally, I just prefer medium with classic rasterization. We also have FSR2, which is compatible with this game, which can help with the FPS and the resolution in some cases. Ray tracing is there as well, but I would suggest you to stick with something like the low preset, as it will be quite harsh on your resources. Anything above that, starting with the medium preset for the graphics, will not get you more than 20 FPS. The Last of Us Part 1 works great after building the shaders. I got an average of around 80 to 100 FPS and around 50-60 FPS in the 1% low at ultra settings. Worth mentioning that for me, it runs natively at 720p for some reason, so I had to use FSR3 to upscale to full HD, which can be noticed sometimes, but not too bad. If you turn on the FSR frame gen, you can get a constant 1% low of around 80 FPS with the quality preset. But in this specific case, you do not really need that, if you ask me. 60 FPS 1% low with an average of 100 frames per second is more than enough for a game like this. As for other titles, in general, you will not have any issue running at 1080p. Even 1440p if we go with something like FSR frame gen and upscaling methods. The experience should be pleasant, and yes, a lot of the newer games will probably need to run at lower settings, which normally is fine for most of the people. I only mentioned FSR, but Intel have their proprietary AI upscaling and frame generation technology, XeSS, which seems to be working better, but time needs to pass for more games to be compatible. In my case, no game was compatible with XeSS. So yeah, however, I do promise that a video about XeSS 2 will come in the future. I ran a stress test as well to see where the temperatures are getting under constant hassle. For Mark 2.6 at full HD preset, 100% usage, but the temperature on the GPU never went over 64, 65 degrees Celsius, and the memory stayed at around 53, 54 Celsius. The average FPS during the test was around 140, even though most of the times I was seeing like 125, 130, 133. It got an overall score of 7,900, which I believe it is more than decent. Keep in mind that my specific GPU with this implementation has 3 fans on it, which seem to be doing a great job so far. Now, this GPU is not perfect, obviously. We talked about rebar a bit earlier. Well, for the B580, it is quite an important feature, and in fairness, it will become more important as the time passes, not only for Intel, but for like all the GPU manufacturers. That being said, keep in mind that rebar is not only GPU dependent, you also need to have a compatible CPU and motherboard for that. The motherboard should be fine, really. You can find some good deals for something like what I got in my system. And the CPUs as well, like the newer models, will have no issue. You just need to keep this in mind in case you have an older build and you want to upgrade the GPU. As for processors, any Ryzen CPU, as far as I'm aware, should do the trick. But if you are an Intel guy, you will need at least the 10th generation of Intel Core processors. As I said, in case you just want to upgrade your GPU. Okay, let's talk a bit about budget. For a gaming PC, you do not really need my specs. For example, you can lower down the RAM to 16 gigabytes instead of 32. The chip can be something like the 5700X or even the 5600X. The motherboard, you can go with something like the B450 and so on. The main idea is that you can build a PC to fit a tighter budget using this GPU, the Intel Arc B580. Competitors. The direct competitor for this would be the NVIDIA RTX 4060, but as far as things go, the 4000 lineup is out of production, so we will need to wait until maybe 5060, which will probably outperform the Arc B580, but the price will most likely be questionable. Again, AMD comes with a Radeon RX 7600, which is cheaper, like $50 cheaper, but only comes with 8 GB of RAM, smaller bus size, and share pretty much the same upscaling and frame generation technologies as this Intel does. Still, a decent choice if you want to save on that department or the budget simply does not allow it. As I mentioned earlier, the Sparkle Titan OC Arc B580 costs around $360 here in Eastern Europe. The RTX 4060 is around the same price, $350, and the RX 7600 is around that $300 mark. Conclusion, is the Intel Arc B580 worth the money and the hype? I would say yes, especially considering that Intel pushes and offers quite some good software support, as well as a deal in which I got the Assassin's Creed Shadows. I cannot wait to play it. It is reliable, it performs well, it stays cool, and keeps its head up in front of the competition. Yes, it is not perfect. Gaming-wise, is not the best in its category. The 4060 is simply better optimized for most of the games, but not by a big margin. And the newer 5060 and probably the RX 9060 will outperform it with ease. The main takeaway here is Intel remembered how to make GPUs, and that can only bring good vibes and competition in a market which desperately needs it. Now, I want to hear your opinions on this topic. What do you think about the new commander in our studio? Did you get one for your build? If yes, how does it perform for you? Are you happy with the choice? Also, if you are thinking about building a PC or upgrading your PC, do you take into consideration this Intel Arc B580? I'm waiting for your answers. down below in the comment section, as well as feedback regarding the channel. And we will start streaming this week, Saturday at 6 p.m. GMT. I'm waiting for you here on this channel to play some games, to discuss different topics, and have a good time overall. If you have any recommendation for games or topics to discuss, I'm waiting for them here. That's it for this video. I hope you liked it and found it useful. As always, we would be more than grateful if you would give us a like and a subscribe. I will see you guys with the next video. Until then, take care of yourself. Bye-bye.